Welcome to Hydrogeology 101 Groundwater Exploration. It's a dream of every hydrogeologist to drill a successful water well, like this one here, which we drilled for the United Nations camp in Timbuktu, Mali a couple of years ago. Sometimes our wells are not only successful, but also high yielding, so congratulations to the Afghan engineers who drilled this well in Kabul. There is a problem, however. Surface water is always easy to find. You can see it with your own eyes, whereas groundwater is mostly invisible, and if we want to look for it, it costs us a lot of time and, more importantly, a lot of money because we have to drill in order to verify if it's there or not. My name is Andreas de Jong, and in this short video I'd like to talk about my preferred groundwater exploration strategy. We should split every groundwater exploration project into a number of distinct phases. The first phase is the depth study and baseline survey. It's not that expensive, and at the end of it, we can decide whether we stop the project, proceed with caution, or give it a green light. During the depth study, what we want to do is to collect as much information as we can about the project area. So that includes the geological maps, maybe some satellite images, and any information whatsoever to do with water resources, so not just groundwater. If there is information on groundwater, great, but don't forget your surface water flows, precipitation, and so on, because we don't just want to find the right place to drill the water well, we also want to look at its long-term sustainability and effects of climate change. Now, our DES study will result in a DES study report, where we put everything into a neat little report which will decide for us if we want to continue with the project or not. If we continue, it's usually a good idea to carry out a baseline survey. Now, sometimes the baseline survey is done at the same time or maybe even before the depth study. It just depends on your project and doesn't really matter. But it is important to carry out a baseline survey because most of the data that we use in a depth study is usually out of date. Now, during the baseline survey, we want to visit as many different water points as we possibly can. The more, the better. So all these existing wells, you need to know how deep is the static water level, get some idea about water quality, maybe measure the electrical conductivity, maybe take some samples. But most important of all is to talk with the well owners. Ask them when they drilled the well. How deep was it? Has there been any problems over time in terms of quantities or qualities? Don't forget to look at surface water resources as well. In this stream here, which is in the dry season, we can see it's still flowing, and that means it is sustained by groundwater. So we can always think about not just groundwater, but also the whole water cycle when we look for groundwater. Now, our baseline survey will result in a baseline survey report. It doesn't have to be anything very elaborate. This could be just a series of maps and some tables, which is then part of our depth study report. But basically, what we want to do is, again, to decide whether the project goes ahead or not. If we have a green light, this is the time when we design our geophysical survey and we write the geophysical tender documents. We need to know where are we going to look for groundwater, how deep should be the depth of investigation, how many locations should be surveyed, and so on. So let's assume that our phase one is completed successfully, and we're now going to do phase two, which is the geophysical survey. The geophysical survey is a little bit more expensive, but at the end of it, we can decide whether to stop the project, to proceed with caution, or to give it a green light. So this is the advantage of the phased approach of groundwater exploration. At any point, we can stop the project if we think that the risks are too high. Now, we've written our tender documents previously. Now we're going to launch the geophysical survey tender. And again, before we award it to a contractor, we have to make sure that this person or company is actually able to do the geophysical survey. If we just award to the cheapest contractor and they do a rubbish job, basically our whole project will fail. So it's very important that we select the right people to do the job. Sometimes the right people is ourselves. So here is an example of me doing a magnetic survey in the plains of Accra in Ghana. Here is a more traditional resistivity survey in one of the wadis near Nizwa in Oman. And once we finish the geophysical survey, we're going to interpret the data. And it's very important that our geophysical survey is designed in such a way that we can work out what is the depth of the aquifer and also how it changes over distance, so that we can select the correct places to do our drilling and also to know how deep the well should be. This is an example from the Balochistan desert of Pakistan, where an existing well was drilled here. In fact, two wells were drilled here. They were both dry. And then following the geophysical survey, we saw that the resistivity increases towards the northwest. So we located three drill sites, always successful. Example here is from Ghana. We're looking for a fracture zone, and we managed to find it here from our geophysical profiling. And we did a VES, which showed that also here the weathering is down at about 80, 90 meters. So we drilled a well here, also successful. Now, the geophysical survey should result in a geophysical survey report, usually written by the geophysicist. And if it looks successful, then we move ahead and use the geophysical survey information to write the specifications for the drilling tender documents. By that I mean how many wells should be drilled and how deep. So the well depth is not some kind of speculation, it is based on the results of the geophysical survey. Okay, so our geophysical survey has been successful. We're now moving on to phase three, drilling and pumping tests. This is the most expensive part of groundwater exploration. And often all people look at is this budget here, and they want to move ahead with this as fast as possible, and they want to ignore these study phases, the baseline survey, depth study, and geophysical survey. But actually, we have to be very careful that we do a good job before we start drilling to reduce the chances of not drilling successful wells. Okay, so we launch our drilling tender, and if everything is okay, we will award it to a drilling contractor. Now, do not be afraid to not award this tender. If you don't have a good contractor, don't go ahead with the project. You can always re-tender your drilling until you have the right company, the right person to carry out the drilling. Because if you don't have a good drilling contractor, they're going to mess up your wells and you will not have a successful project. Here is some pictures more from Timbuktu in Mali. And at this stage of the project, the most important person of the project, it's not you, is this guy here, the driller. Because if you have a good driller, he's going to do what you ask him to do and drill some good wells for you. If you have a bad driller, he's going to mess up your wells, they'll collapse, and he'll say there's no water and the project will fail. So show some respect for the driller and make sure you establish a good relationship with him. Okay, now the output of this drilling and pumping test is a report which is usually written by the drilling contractor. Now, the report will contain all the data from the drilling and testing, but the interpretation, of course, has to be done by you, the hydrogeologist. And that's usually done in what I call a groundwater exploration report. So that report will contain not only all the drilling and testing data, but also information from the depth study, the baseline survey if you've done one, the geophysical survey report, and finally, you want to do a bit of analysis as well to look at aquifer sustainability, recharge rates, and so on. Sometimes it is justified to do modeling, but I would say that's only really important if we're designing a well field. For most projects, you don't have to do modeling. Okay, so what I'd like you to take away from this little video is that the best strategy for groundwater exploration is a phased approach, which you can stop at any time if you think there's something wrong either with the project area or maybe the procedures, and that there's a risk that you're going to waste money in the future. So we only invest in the subsequent phases of the project if we feel confident that there's a reasonably good chance of having a successful project. I'd like to end with a positive note here. This was the highest yielding well ever drilled in Kidal in northern Mali. We had to locate a regional fracture which goes underneath these surface deposits of this wadi, so it's very difficult to find. And we managed to drill a well with over 20 liters per second. So congratulations to my friends and colleagues in Kidal, if you're listening. And that's it. I hope you enjoyed the video. And thank you very much for your attention.